Welcome to Expo Today Live. With me now is Phupinder Gill, the CEO of the CME Group. Gill, thanks for joining us.
Pleasure. Good to see you.
I'd like to ask you a few questions about some comments that were made earlier today by the chairman of the CFTC, Gary Gensler. He raised a question about LIBOR, which he said is based on fiction, not fact, and said the world really needs to move to different benchmarks, given the fact that these reference rates are such a key foundation for a big part of your business. Does this potential transition pose a threat to CME's business and interest rate complex?
Yeah, I don't think so. I think I listened to what he had to say, and he's right. The way the LIBOR survey is being done, it's not based on transactions.
Right.
So in the perfect of all worlds, having a transaction-based system does make sense. But as he also pointed out, 70% of the interest rate market, more than 70%, is actually based on LIBOR. There's
right.
a reality there that you cannot ignore, and that reality is seeing the regulators around the world taking what I would describe to be a more balanced approach with respect to understanding and realizing that any benchmark, whether it's based on perception or based on transaction, would be susceptible to some kind of manipulation. You have a benchmark that is understood by a client base that's very large. You have a benchmark that is used now. You are prosecuting all those guys that did wrong things in the past. You're getting those things behind you. And once those are behind you, focusing on making sure the benchmark that you use is being used in the right way is the approach that we are seeing regulators other than the CFTC take. They're not extreme views. One extreme view would be there's nothing wrong with LIBOR, let it continue.
Right.
Another extreme view is throw it out, and because we need a new benchmark. So it's a new target is what I see. And if you look at what folks such as the FSA, Martin, Wheatley, Mark Carney, all these European regulators, it seems to us, are taking a much more balanced approach here.
Well, that's good news. Yeah. I'd like to shift now to swap execution facilities. As I'm sure many people here know, there's now somewhere more than a dozen of these trading venues emerging, but it's still not clear exactly what that new market structure will look like. So I think the question that a lot of people here at the show and here in Chicago wonder is, are there opportunities for the trading firms that have brought so much liquidity to future exchanges? Or rather, in your opinion, when do you think that new market structure will really be ripe for trading firms to come in and do the same kinds of things they have been doing on CME and other futures exchanges?
Now, keep in mind a few things here. Unlike how the other markets have evolved, the futures market evolved since 1989 from the time Eurex and CME put out an electric platform. That platform, the way it existed then and the way it exists now, are night and day. This, the CEF environment will have to go through a similar kind of shakeout. And once that shakeout is done, you'll see a market structure emerge that will create opportunities within the bounds of safety and soundness for the same folks that are trading futures now. It's going to take a while. I think one of the lessons learned the European regulators can pick up from what occurred here is don't rush the timing of very important implementations such as CEF. There's a lot of confusion out there. I'm confident it'll sort itself out. I'm confident there'll be a lot more CEFs that come about, but the market structure that exists in the future side now, don't expect that to occur to the CEFs anytime soon.
Well, I'm going to press you on that. So
yeah, do.
If I were making a strategic plan for 2014, 2015, and I were a trading firm here in Chicago, should I allocate my resources to connecting to CEFs and investigating the opportunities, or should I say, you know what, let's wait for the dust to settle?
I think it's a ground floor opportunity. If you're a forward thinking firm and you wanted to trade for the future, I think you would start to make that investment now if you haven't already done so.
Fair enough. Let me just turn to another really critical issue for this industry, which is customer protection.
Yes.
As you know, MF Global, one of the largest firms, failed several years ago. The good news is that I believe as of today or yesterday, we have confirmation that 100% of the customer money will be returned.
Yeah.
The question is, though, it's not just about getting the money back. It's also about trust.
Yes.
In your opinion, has the industry, CME included, done enough to restore customer confidence in the system of customer protections that we have?
I think the short answer to that question is yes. I think if you look at all the things that exist now that did not exist when MF Global went down, it is night and day. In fact, one of the controls that we put in place helped to catch yet another fraudster, PFG. And so a lot of the things that we're doing, which is holding our FCMs more accountable for the funds of their clients, making sure the funds are in the accounts, putting the CEO and the CFO on the hook to make sure that client funds are kept in the accounts, are just a few of the myriad of changes and the overall bright light that's shining on the practices of FCMs, the vast majority of whom are doing a great job.
It's good
but
to hear.
These things that we put in place does restore the confidence of our client base.
You talk to clients, I'm sure, all the time.
We do.
I think there was a lot of concern, particularly outside of the United States. People really thought, my gosh, do you think that really has been addressed? Do you think the customers here in the United States, around the world, really feel like their money is safe in the U.S. system?
Yes, I think the customers in the U.S. actually do feel their funds are more safe now. The FCMs that they deal with are engaged in deeper dialogue with each one of these things. There's more transparency between the FCMs and their clients, which is all a big plus for us. And customers outside of the U.S. who understand the bankruptcy regimes that they have to deal with are actually on board with all the things that have occurred here.
Well, that's good to hear. Well, look, Gil, thank you so much for joining us.
Bill, good to see you.
Thank you all for tuning in to Expo Today Live.